people, they only think about the region as well for some oil-producing countries, but it's actually only a few countries who have this, but the country has, at some point, some of the poorest countries in the world and also the most populated countries, like my country, Egypt. So we need very much to discuss this at the level of civil society, at the level of stakeholders. And I'm happy that we have already started this with our partners a long time ago, but we are continuing to do that. This said, event is going to reflect on some of the challenges, experiences that we have, and also what we can do together for the future. So again, welcome to our SAD event. Thank you very much for all our speakers today. From Cannes International, my friend Harjeet, and from NRC, my dear friend Nina. And let me give the floor now to Nina, because Nina is going to be the moderator for this event. And I'll come back to you with my presentation later. Nina, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Emad, and welcome everyone in the room and everyone online. We don't know how many it is, but I know there's at least a few people online as well. We have this event today very much to try to link what's happening on resilience, loss and damage, and people on the move, both people who move by choice and people who are forced to flee. So when we try to work together between RAED, the Rosa-Luxemburg-Stiftung, and the Norwegian Refugee Council to conceptualize this, we wanted very much to start from a resilience perspective and what's happening in the Arab region, especially since the next COP will take place in Egypt. And we very much saw that loss and damage due to climate change is increasing in both magnitude and frequency, and demonstrated in countries all over the world, as well as in the Arab region. And loss and damage is the hot issue in the days and the discussions, both the formal and informal here. And we really see that this has evolved over the past decade to become what many call a third pillar under the UNFCCC, alongside mitigation and adaptation. If you go back to COP21 in Paris in 2015, parties agreed to establish a task force on displacement to avert, minimize, and address displacement related to adverse impacts of climate change as part of the Warsaw International Mechanism. In 2019, the task force delivered its recommendations to COP24 and has begun a second phase of implementation. Additionally, displacement will be addressed as a part of the Santiago network on averting, minimizing, and addressing loss and damage. So we see different policy areas and parts of the negotiations coming together. We therefore see it's very important of addressing the climate change, human mobility nexus, and it's becoming more important under several other policy areas. One thing is here at the UNFCCC negotiations, but it's also being discussed under the Sendai framework on disaster risk reduction. Just 2 weeks ago, there was a global platform in Indonesia where it also was one of the issues, and we also had an event there where we tried to connect the DRR and the loss and damage discussion. A month ago, there was a big meeting in New York on the International Migration Review Forum, and we also have one of our presenters today who participated there, and we really see it's important to make the linkages between these policy areas to help countries minimize their both displacement risk, enhance regular migration pathways, and strengthen community resilience. So in the panel today, we have quite a good variation of people, both where we come from, what we work on, but I think we are all very much on the same message when it comes to the real issues. We will start today with a presentation from Ambassador Shahira Wabi from the League of Arab States. We had hoped that we also would be able to have an opening from the COP presidency team, but they told us just a few minutes before we started that unfortunately they stuck in meetings so they couldn't join us. So we will then move to Ambassador Shahira Wabi, and she could not log on, but no, she is online, she's online. Yes. So we don't need to do video, we will have Shahira live, thank you. So Ambassador Shahira Wabi, please join us, and we will have the technician help us put her on the screen.
She's online.
Just 1 second. We move from video to reality.
I think she is there.
Then, Ambassador Shaira, can you please start?
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes. Loud and clear. Yes. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Let me thank you first for giving me the floor. I have been requested to give a small intervention on building resilience, loss damages, and experiences of human mobility in the Arab region. The Global Compact on Refugees recognizes that climate and environmental degradation and the resulting disasters are increasingly affecting the drivers of refugee movements. It also calls for the Global Compact on Refugees to include refugees in disaster risk reduction strategies. The League of Arab States is following up on the process of the Global Refugee Agreement and seeking to translate it into tangible improvement in the lives of refugees and their host communities in the region, and seeking to develop effective future plans. Thus, is also following up on the implementation of the Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction, the Paris Agreements, and the Sustainable Development Goals and Agenda. Human mobility is high on the agenda in the implementation of these strategies in the Arab region. As you know, human mobility in the context, in the context of climate change is addressed through the Cancun Framework for Adaptation, as well as the Paris Agreement and the Warsaw International Mechanism for Loss and Damage Consideration. The Arab region had a large and influential role in drafting these global documents, which was reflected in the work of the Arab region in following up implementation. One of the most important goals that the Arab region seeks to enable it to deal with the climate change and the human mobility is the issue of strengthening the capacity to confront these things. There are about 5.12 million people living in internal displacement due to conflicts and violence across the Arab region by the end of 2020. On the other hand, climate change and natural disasters such as droughts, rains, floods, and hurricanes, which most Arab countries witness in varying degrees in intensity and frequency, do not only deteriorate the environment and the economy, but also lead to undermining the livelihood of the population. It has serious social and political repercussions, insecurity and peace in the region. The Arab challenges in dealing with human mobility, the most important of which is the issue of data and statistics on human mobility and on the disasters themselves, especially slow impact disasters such as desertification. And if we add to this that the organized collection of information is related to the times of a sudden disasters only in the region, we find that there is no solid scientific basis to support decision making. This requires the adoption of a systematic approach to fill the gap in data. On the other hand, there is an urgent need in the Arab region to provide appropriate tools for needs assessment. And follow up.
Ambassador Shahira, Wabi, I think we have a problem with the connection on the internet, so we lost you after you said about the urgent need. So if you can hear us. I think if.
No.
I suggest we try to get her connected again and then let her come back later.
Yes.
And we then move to the next speaker because she will also be speaking about the information in from the Arab region. So let's see if we can get Ambassador Shahira back after. The next speaker is also online. It's Manuela Kurka from the IDMC, the International Displacement Monitoring Center, which is part of NRC. And she will very much help us to set the stage when it comes both to what are the numbers, what is the impact of climate change and displacement in the same area and together with the same people. So Manuela, I'll hand over to you, and we hope that we have better connection with you, and then we hope to get back to the ambassador after. So Manuela, please, we will do the PowerPoint from here.
Excellent, Nina. Thank you so much for the introduction. It is a pleasure to be here. My name is Manuela Kurka, and I work at the Internal Displacement Monitoring Center. IDMC is a part of the Norwegian Refugee Council. Can you see my screen? Presentation?
Yeah, we see it here, and I think you should see it also. So I think we can go to the next slide. And then you just tell us, Manuela, when we should move.
Will do, thank you. Well, I'm a part of the IDMC. IDMC is a part of the Norwegian Refugee Council. IDMC collects and provides data and analysis on internal displacement around the world. And we hope that this data and analysis informs policymaking that can support and provide assistance to IDPs around the world. We also publish each year the Global Report on Internal Displacement. Last year, we just published our most recent report, which indicates that 38 million people were displaced that there were 38 million internal displacements around the world due to both armed conflict and disasters. Now, the majority of these were internal displacements due to disasters, 23.7 million. Could you please go to the next slide? Thank you, and this provides an overview of the internal displacements that we recorded. Next slide, please. And based on our estimates, we also estimate that as of the end of last year, there were 59.1 million people who remained internally displaced as of the end of the year. And out of these, 5.9 million were internally displaced by disasters. Now, keep in mind that this figure is probably an underestimate because there is significant lack of data on internal displacement and its duration due to disasters. Next slide, please. And now we will focus on internal displacement in the Arab region in particular. Now, there were significant and some noteworthy trends worth highlighting. Between 2010 and 2021, there were 6.2 million internal displacement movements due to disasters in the Arab region. Out of these, the majority were due to floods, followed by drought, then earthquakes, storms, and wildfires. Next slide, please. And we also identified significant internal displacement due to disasters last year. Last year, we recorded 560,000 disaster internal displacement in Arab regions. Additionally, we estimate that more than 134,000 IDPs remain displaced by disasters as of the end of the year, combining MENA and wider Arab region countries. We identified that last year, 2021, was a year of extreme weather events. We saw heavy rains and floods that displaced thousands of people, followed by long and worsening drought and drought conditions that also displaced high numbers of people. We also saw that among the most vulnerable populations were IDPs who had already been displaced by conflict, who had already been displaced by disasters, and who were then again displaced by disasters. This was the case, for example, in Syria, Yemen, and Libya, when floods triggered repeated displacement, or in Iraq, where fires displaced IDPs from their IDP camp. Drought and drought conditions are worsening across the region. We also recorded cyclones, wildfires, and severe floods across the region. Next slide, please. Now, we have identified, based on this data and this analysis, some important challenges, opportunities, and also recommendations. Now, there is overall a lack of systematic monitoring of disaster displacement in some of these countries and contexts, particularly when you compare it to the monitoring of conflict displacement in these regions, which enjoy much more comprehensive coverage and analysis. So there are some important data gaps. There are data gaps on disaster displacement, the numbers of people displaced, but also on the duration of disaster displacement. There is sometimes a myth that conflict displacement triggers more severe or more protracted displacement, but what we have found is that disaster also can trigger protracted, severe, and devastating long-term displacement. There are also data gaps on slow onset events. And there are in particular some challenges in the detection and monitoring of drought displacement. So this is a type of displacement that is harder to capture, that is harder to measure, because it happens after a sequence of events. First, a drought starts, then food insecurity sets in, a rise in food prices. And so we need to work with partners to follow this chain of events and see where displacement is occurring. We're also seeing that compounding crises, including conflict, food insecurity, and disasters, are making displacement more protracted, are worsening the humanitarian crises of these IDPs. But there is also an opportunity, as we're seeing with this event and others that are taking place today and tomorrow. There is an increasing awareness of disaster displacement and the link between climate and human mobility, and we can mobilize this awareness to trigger additional investment and support for data collection, but also support for these IDPs. So among our recommendations are first to address the very needed data gaps to make sure that we have good and targeted solutions and responses. We also need to improve and strengthen the shelters that IDPs who have already been displaced live in, because we see that IDPs living in vulnerable shelters are more vulnerable to disasters and to disaster displacement. We should also increase investment in durable solutions, increasing reconstruction of destroyed houses by disasters, and also preparing urban areas for the IDPs who will arrive, who have been displaced by drought, and give them new job opportunities and vocational training. And of course, we also call for continued adoption of disaster risk reduction, climate change adaptation, and mitigation efforts. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you very much, Manuela. And you get a big applause from the room here. And really, thank you for being able to present such a magnitude of information in a very, very short time. But I think it also builds on what you at IDMC have done for more than 10 years now, collecting this information and analyzing it. I'm sure there are questions and comments, but we'll save them to after the presentation so we can also kind of have a discussion based on everything. So keep your questions for Manuela. She will stay online with us. We will continue with the next presentation, also focusing on the Arab region. The next presenter will be Dr. Emad Adly, here next to me, and then we will put the video with Ambassador Shayabai after, and then we... Oh, she's back, so then we will have her live after Dr. Emad. Okay. So we go with Emad, and please, Ambassador, stay online, and then after Emad, we invite you. So, Emad, he is the general coordinator for RAED, the Arab Network for Environment and Development. And I think when we look on the issues around human mobility in the context of climate change, we have worked on this together for more than a decade. And as I said, I think we've been doing events at many sessions, but I think today is especially exciting because we now also can talk much more about loss and damage than in the past. Emad, over to you.
Thank you very much, Nina, and again, welcome to all of you. Let me go very quickly within the 5-6 minutes I have on my presentation, just to tell you, next please. The Arab regional context when it comes to risk, because geopolitically and the socioeconomic situation in the region is really risky from different aspects, and I think you hear from the news what's going on in most of the countries in the region. I don't want to name it, but you can talk about Syria, you can talk about Iraq, you can talk about Yemen, you can talk about Jordan, Palestine, Mauritania, it's really Somalia, it's really Sudan, it's really have a lot of challenges, especially when it comes to the geopolitical issues. And then when it comes to the risks because of the climate change, we are facing all the different types, because we are talking about extreme temperatures and precipitation events. We are talking about climate-related hazards such as heat waves, droughts, floods, cyclones, and sand and dust storms. Actually, when it comes to drought, we consider the drought has its highest impact on the region, especially when it comes to food security and water security. 70 or more than 70% of the water, the freshwater resources for this region comes from outside the region, which makes it more problematic and more challenging for the region. So this is why I want to confirm what Ambassador Shahira said, and then we will hear about it again in her video, the need for the database and the information, the data. So I was very happy to hear some of the data, and we still have some of the data happening, but all of them are sometimes not reflecting the reality that's coming from the region and also shows how the region is facing. But definitely there is a need to have a role for not only the scientific and academic institutions, but we need also a role for the civil society in collecting the data, because if we, without having the data and without having enough information about this, the risk, we will not be able to make the resilience happening. These are some of the numbers to show you in some of the countries I collected, you know, the data coming from the UNDRR website. Our recent studies that they have, but you can see that most of the, we are talking about between 1980 and to 2012 or 2013 with the numbers of events. And some places like in Lebanon, you are talking about more than 2,500 events, but you are also the houses destroyed and the houses damaged and number of deaths. It is really high when it comes to you know, one, we are talking about only about six countries, and with the available resources and the data that is in the region. So this is why we think, and I put this a very special slide for the issue of collecting data on the loss and damage. And here, when we are in Bonn and we are preparing for Sharm el Sheikh, the issue of loss and damage is a high priority for the region and for the communities. I can just tell you about, you know, a farmer that I go and visit, and he tells me that I lost 70 or 80% of my crop this year because of the heat wave or the cold wave. So who is going to compensate me for that? And this person is paying for the education for his children, health, medical, food, and so all this. So there's actually, you know, when it comes to loss and damage, when it comes to the region, that we have a priority. I'm sure this is happening also in other regions, but at least having two COPs coming in the region, we want to see how this will be reflected on the policies and on the implementation of what we hear here in the COPs. Next, please. This is also some of the figures that relates to loss and damage in figures from six countries related to drought, earthquake, snowstorm, forest fire, and so on. We covered Lebanon, Jordan, Palestine, Morocco, and Tunisia. You can see that, you know, Yemen, of course, has taken the biggest when it comes to combined economic losses. Yemen has a very difficult situation, and I think we need to think about situation, you know, in countries that has the, you know, the highest level of poverty and also challenges. Next, please. So the importance of the community resilience has become increasingly recognized in the in emergency management and post-disaster community well-being. But this is not enough, because we are doing a lot in the region for the response. But when it comes to the preventive and how we can stop and how we can build the resilience of the communities, I think we need an urgent move on this, because it's not enough to have only the response, and our communities are not ready to be only suffering and then we come and see them. We have to be working with them from the beginning. And here the self-adaptive capacity of community resilience is mainly embodied in four aspects: economic development, the social capital, the information and communication, and the community skills. When it comes to civil society and the role that we are playing at RAED, my organization, the Arab Network for Environment and Development, We are trying very much to work on the issues of information and communication, community skills, and also to build on this social capital. But when it comes to economic development, you need also some policies and some support from government and from internationally to be able to do that. Next, please. What are the community? What are the challenges that we are facing? For I have put here 10 challenges, but of course the first one that came in the last couple of years, the COVID-19, which became another challenge on top of what we are facing. What we have achieved in the first 5-6 years of implementation with the SDGs, we found ourselves getting back many steps, not one or two steps. Of course, the poverty and inequality when it comes between urban and rural and between some countries and other countries, it is really between north and south in some countries. Unsustainable management of natural resources, which it's also another challenge. Wars and conflicts, you can talk about them very easily and you can find many examples. Resources are allocated, of course, only for response but not for preparedness. Weak coordination and governance. This is one of the issues that we have to think about when it comes to climate action governance. This is very important. I was talking about this also in the last 2 days, because solution is not coming. Sometimes governments, they think that they have the solution and they have the wisdom and the skills to do that by themselves. But unfortunately, it never works out without having the good governance and the involvement and the engagement of the different stakeholders. Lack of financial resources, weak community participation, lack of awareness, and capacities, weak legislative frameworks, which this really also need us to involve parliamentarians and the members of the different parliaments. So the roles here for our civil society, we are pushing for the advocacy, service provision, expertise, capacity building, representation, and we want to contribute to policy, and we already had this, to policy and strategy analysis. We are trying to do this now with the national strategies on climate change in our countries. It is very difficult, it's very challenging to become part of this, to be engaged in this, and we want to assist in the implementation. I heard some people, and we are always talking, we are not here for advocacy as civil society, but we have examples of how to do it at the grassroots with a small scale, medium scale, and even large scale project. Enhance the engagement and also facilitate knowledge and exchange and sharing of good practices with other regions. And we are happy to be in Sharm el-Sheikh in November representing Africa, and we want to use this to also to build on the capacity and the exchange between African countries. Last slide here. We have to invest at the local level. This is my messages here. Invest at the local level, strengthen the coordination and coherence. We want to have the community engagement. We cannot just put them as recipients. We have to include them, and they are the core of everything we are doing. Learn from the experience we had with the COVID-19, effective partnerships without it. One plus one, when it is partnerships, it's more than two. The result will be more than this. Of course, strengthen the climate action governance that I talked about. And we are very much pushing for the education. So we are working with schools and universities, because we know that with formal, informal, and non-formal education, we make a difference. Data is a big issue, and we have to make it available and accessible. Efficient early warning systems, respect the traditional knowledge, which we have solutions for many of the problems we are facing with the traditional knowledge. Link scientific research, science to policy is also one of the challenges, and one of the messages that we always giving to our policymakers: please look at the science, look at the information that we have and we gather, and you have to build your decision based on that. And synergies and awareness raising. I have the messages here. I leave it to our moderator to think about it at the end. But I'm happy to be with you, and thank you very much for listening to us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Emad. And you covered a lot. So I think it's great. Not very quickly, but I think it was still very clear. And I hope that the people really listen, because I think how to bring not just the outside into the COP, but also how to really have the Arab communities being involved and very visible in Egypt is important. We will continue to stay in the Arab region. We will try to go back to Ambassador Shahira Wahbi. I think you are now online and the internet is with us. So let's try live, and if not, we have a video backup. So Ambassador, please come back.
Thank you very much. Actually, I was glad that to get disconnected, because when I came online again, I found that the issue of data and information has been raised by Ms. Emanuela, who spoke about me, and it was again raised by Dr. Emad. And I think that's why it is one of the most important issues concerning the issue of resilience. And if we add to this that the organized collection of information is related only to the times of sudden disasters, we find that there is no scientific base to support decision-making. This requires the adoption of a systematic approach to fill in the gap in data. And I think many of the presenters have agreed with me on this point. On the other hand, there is an urgent need in the Arab region to provide appropriate tools for needs assessment, risk analysis, investment planning, and progress follow-up, with priority given to providing national and local authorities with the necessary financial and technical support to take the necessary measures for planning, building resilience, and working on the participation of the Development Act of the development sector in the implementation of long-term initiatives for recovery. And I think this also has been highlighted by Dr. Emad in his presentation, the importance of the local authorities. One important issue is the legislative aspect of human mobility, a vital factor that can affect the achievement of resilience. National laws and policies related to human mobility must be reviewed to ensure their integration into disaster risk reduction. It is necessary that they are consistent with legal and international instruments, including the guiding principles on internal displacement, migration, human rights, and refugee law. Since all Arab countries are developing countries, allocating the necessary resources at all administrative levels and across all relevant sectors to support building resilience in the Arab region is a top priority. This constitutes the basis for the Arab region interest in the Paris Agreement's affirmation of the Warsaw International Loss and Damage Mechanism as the main tool within the framework of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change process, to avoid, reduce, and address loss and damages associated with the effect of climate change. Therefore, what is required is the real activation of this agreement and implementing it through the establishment of global partnerships to collect and systematically evaluate practices and experiences and share them while facilitating learning and support between peers and planning to deal with climate change in an objective and equitable manner. It is inevitably necessary to take into account the respective capabilities of the countries and support their sustainable development efforts in order to enable them to build resilience in their country and in their communities. Only through this way can the countries deal with the human mobility issue at the national level and control its eruption outside its borders. Let me conclude by saying that as long as there are stable and advanced places in the world, people who suffer will choose to move to these places that are more stable, safe, and with better living conditions. The moment they face any risk, whether emanating from nature or man-made. So we have no solution but to build the resilience, not of our own countries or localities or regions, but we need to achieve a resilient, fair world. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Shahira. I really hope that you can stay with us until the question and discussion that I think we will start in about 15, 20 minutes. So please stay on the line if it's possible, because I'm sure there will be comments and questions also to you. We will move on and continue to stay in the Arab region. We heard about drought, and one of our next speakers now is Ms. Samah Hadid, who's working in the NRC office in the Middle East. She's based in Jordan, and she will talk a lot about the work we as NRC are doing there related to drought and displacement, and link it to the impacts of climate change on the pre-existing vulnerabilities and risk of displacement. So, Samah, over to you.
Thank you. Just wanted to double check you can hear me clearly. All good?
All good. Please go.
Great. Well, as Nina said, I'm currently in Jordan, so I think this is a very apt and relevant place to be talking about climate change. At the Norwegian Refugee Council, we've already seen the effects of water scarcity, drought, and climate-induced displacement. So we know that climate change is not this far off, you know, threat in the distant future. It's happening now, and we're seeing the effects of it devastate lives today. And so the discussions you're having now in Bonn and elsewhere as well, bilaterally with governments, I think need to reflect the urgency that we're seeing on the ground in climate hotspots. We've been hearing a lot now already on the panel about the lack of data, the lack of monitoring, the lack of information. And at NRC in the Middle East region, we're really trying to bridge this gap through the existing systems that we have to assess needs, assess trends, and assess the impacts that, you know, these trends and these patterns are having on the day-to-day lives of people, particularly vulnerable displaced communities. We've recently been documenting the effects that climate-induced drought and water scarcity has had in vulnerable pockets across the region, particularly Iraq, which is a context that is facing a huge displacement crisis from years of conflict, and now is getting worse because of climate-induced drought and rising temperatures. I mean, you all would have seen the recent sandstorms and dust storms in the news in Iraq, and how this is already leading to poor health conditions. So I think, you know, we need to go beyond the statistics, we need to go beyond the data as well, and actually assess how this is having a human impact right now, today. Because I think these policy discussions often miss that element. In Iraq, over the past few months, we've been surveying communities and families that have been hit by severe drought and record low rainfall. And we found that many farmers have fallen into debt in an attempt to keep their livestock alive. The research revealed that one in two families in drought-affected areas need food assistance already. Farmers told us that due to water and the drought crisis, they're seeing their sole source of living destroyed in front of their eyes. And these extreme circumstances have forced people to leave their homes, compounding, as I already mentioned, an existing displacement crisis in the country. One in 15 households told NRC that a family member had migrated in search of work and income. And this is also particularly affecting young people. So drought conditions, undoubtedly, climate-induced drought has begun to increase displacement across the country. In addition, IDPs and returnees already displaced by conflict are also now on the move again and migrating because of a lack of access to water supply. And the situation is similar if we look at Syria as well. We're also based and we have operations on the ground. There are displaced Syrians who have suffered from conflict and now have to struggle to access water due to record low rainfall and climate-induced drought, as well as reduced water flow from upstream countries and neighboring countries. So we've heard already from others that millions of people across fragile and conflict-affected ravaged areas in our region have suffered the consequences of war and displacement and now have to deal with the consequences of climate change. I mean, it's been said that climate change is the threat multiplier in our region. And conflict-affected Arab states are more vulnerable and less equipped to deal with the effects on the ground. Right now, there are serious gaps in addressing how fragile and conflict-affected countries in our region are dealing with the added effects of climate change. And these countries, of course, as we all know, are among the most water-stressed countries in the world. If we look ahead, the forecasts and the trends are clear. We will see more people on the move due to climate-induced displacement in our region. But also, in addition to that, I think displacement patterns from sub-Saharan Africa may lead to people on the move in the Middle East and North African region, which is already seen as a transit and destination point for many migrants and refugees. So what needs to be done to fill these gaps that we've already discussed? So we've heard about the data gaps, and I won't harp on that. But beyond that, I think we need to see stronger legal protection and humanitarian assistance to those on the move and in displacement due to climate impacts. The migration, displacement, planned relocation considerations need to be part of efforts across adaptation, development, and disaster responses. And human mobility really needs to feature higher as part of those existing responses. Secondly, I think this is a really important issue here. Climate finance mechanisms also have to support solutions for people on the move and those displaced in the context of climate change. As part of this, we need to support fragile conflict-affected countries in our region with guidance on how they can access sustainable, adequate, and predictable finance for addressing climate-related human mobility and loss and damage. And this is crucial if we also want to limit future loss and damage in the region. I think importantly, international financial support to address climate impacts needs to be in addition to existing ODA funding. So ODA levels for development objectives should not be reduced as a result of climate funding. If anything, funding mechanisms need to be climate compatible. And lastly, I'll say that I think at the moment, we really need governments in our region to engage more in climate and water diplomacy. There's a huge intersection here around water politics, obviously climate-induced patterns on the ground, and conflict that needs to be addressed. These are very complex issues. And the upcoming COPs, I think, in our region is a huge opportunity to start really enhancing our understanding of these issues and the policy dialogue around this. I mean, these policy areas are going to be the greatest challenges we face in this fragile region moving forward. So we need to be ready for that. And as part of that effort, we need to ensure that civil society and NGOs climate activists, experts, it's also the people on the ground. We need to ensure that they are part of these discussions as well. The farmers that we met in Iraq and Syria, they told us very clearly, they want to be part of the solution. They want to be part of the policy planning on these agricultural issues, on these water issues, on climate action. So I think, these policy responses, these policy discussions that we're having have to be implemented hand in hand with those who will suffer the most as a result of climate change and its impacts on the ground. So I'll leave it there and happy to take questions afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Samah. And I think really you set the stage very well for the next presentation, because I think when we talk about human mobility, climate change, loss and damage, we look to very many different policy frameworks. And we heard a lot, of course, around the UNFCCC system we are here now. We heard quite a bit about the disaster risk reduction, and we heard a little bit about the displacement and migration. And I think when we look at this, the Global Compact on Migration is maybe the third one that we can pay even more attention to, and I know that any Lestari or next speaker will do that, but I think it's also useful to remind us that before the Global Compact on Migration was signed back in December 2018, the last big meeting where states prepared for the signing in New York was taking place in the Arab region, in Morocco, in Marrakesh. So again, I think it's important to remember the role of the region, but also a lot of these policy frameworks that cover this area, they are also being discussed in that region. So then we will move with a speaker who's not in the Arab region, and not speaking about the Arab region in particular, but Eni Lestari, she's the chair of the International Migrants Alliance. She lives in the Philippines, and Indonesia, I'm being wrong, in Indonesia, and what I think is really key for her presentation today is that from the migration and migrants' perspective, how is the discussion going on acknowledging the climate crisis as a migration and displacement driver? And also, what are the needs to protect people's human rights when they are on the move linked to climate change, whether it's voluntary or forced in these categories we often come up with? And also how to address the socioeconomic political roots of migration and displacement, human mobility. And my final question leads back to the introduction. How can we think and analyze how these discussions connect the different dots of different policy frameworks? So very much, Eni, we're key to hear about what is the situation for people who are climate migrants. So over to you.
Thank you, Madam Moderator. Good afternoon, good evening. My name is Eni Lestari. I'm Indonesian migrant workers based in Hong Kong and the chairperson of International Migrants Alliance, the global alliance of the grassroots migrants, immigrant, refugee, and displaced people. In IMA, we have a motto: for a long time, others have spoken on our behalf. Now we speak for ourselves. We thank the organizers of this event, especially Rosa-Luxemburg-Stiftung, for inviting IMA to speak and share our perspective in this event on unpacking loss and damage or human mobility due to the climate change. Let me just lay down some of our perspective. First, IMA has been at the forefront in promoting the call that nothing about migrants without the migrants. In 2016, we had a golden opportunity to voice out this important message when I, as the IMA chairperson, was given the opportunity to speak at the opening ceremony of the UN General Assembly on large movement of migrants and refugees. In 2022, we echo the same message when I and my fellow grassroots migrant leaders and advocates participate in the International Migration Review Forum on Global Compact on Migration last month at United Nations headquarters, New York City. I was very, very pleased when I heard the same message was echoed by the Director General of the International Organization of Migration in his opening speech during the IMRF inauguration. 6 years later, this call has gained popularity and acceptance worldwide. Various stakeholders recognize the importance of a direct and meaningful participation of grassroots migrants in migration agenda and policy making. Second, on the other side, however, I felt very sad when I listened to the government reports during the first round of IMRF. They claim that the migrants are well protected and our well-being is taken care of. But as a grassroots migrant and community organizer myself, I know their statements are not true. Before and during COVID-19, the migrants have been treated unfairly. Even when the world is crumbling because of during the COVID-19 pandemic, the migrants are forced to survive in whatever condition, even if they become overstayed or get victimized by trafficking and syndicate, just so our loved ones back home will have means to live decently. The ongoing crisis aggravated by the COVID-19 pandemic have magnified the grave condition of migrants. But we notice that every time the global capitalist system experiences its crisis, it is the migrants who are one of the first to be sacrificed. Third, the climate crisis has been acknowledged as one major contributing factor to the worsening impoverishment and the increasing number of people being displaced internally and externally. Post disasters, most affected communities struggle to rebuild back their life with little and even no support by their respective governments, thus many are forced to be overseas migrants. However, the interrelation between the climate crisis and forced migration lacks in-depth study and statistics. Therefore, most policies fail to address this growing phenomenon. Fourth, the climate crisis has also posed direct impacts on the life of overseas migrants and worsened their vulnerability in the countries where they are residing. Many are forced to endure extreme weather from cold to hot summer. Most companies and employers are not regulated to provide preventive measures and protection, such as proper accommodation with heater, aircon, and food. Sally, for example, an Ecuadorian migrant in New York City, shared her personal experience during the grassroots migrant and refugee forum organized by IMA last month. She said her residential area was flooded and destroyed when the tornado hit the city. She struggled to continue her employment while recovering from the disaster. But the New York City government distributed relief and assistance, she cannot access such program because of her irregular status. Thus, she used her own small income to rebuild what has been destroyed. However, her story is not an isolated case and represents millions of migrants out there who experience similar situation. They are displaced from their homeland, trapped in foreign lands as undocumented and excluded from the government assistance. An Indonesian domestic worker in Hong Kong was devastated after her house, where she built from her saving after many years working abroad, was destroyed by the earthquake. She was forced to spend many more years to rebuild her house so her family will have a roof to live on. Again, the government does not offer much assistance for her family and other affected community. Slowly, more young people will seek employment abroad as a means to cope up with this condition and government neglect. Fifth, while the direct and meaningful participation of migrants in migration agenda and policies process is recognized, however, the major problem is that there is no democratic and transparent mechanism created to ensure grassroots migrants' engagement in national, regional, and international levels. The governments do not provide platform for migrants groups to talk to them and be part of the GCM implementation. In addition to this, the requirements to participate at the UN Migration Review have proven very difficult to comply, with no financial and assistant supports provided for the migrants. If these crucial issues are not being addressed, thus it will be very difficult for migrants to be part of the processes, and GCM will eventually become meaningless. Lastly, migrants and advocates have developed international migrant agenda to lay down our realities and aspirations. We spell the kind of changes and reform that we would like to foresee. We should take critical approaches when analyzing the development and migration promoted by the government and even regional and international formation. We should use the lens that the current migration under global capitalism is being shaped by neoliberalism for merely super profit. Because IMA believes that the migrants are human with rights and not object, commodity, or slave to be exploited. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Annie, for putting it so clear. This is about rights and everyone's rights. So thank you so much. Please stay on. We have one more speaker in the room before we open up for questions and comments. Our last speaker is Mr. Harjeet Singh, who I think many of you have seen the last few days being very active. He represents the Climate Action Network. And today we have asked him to share with us thoughts about how human mobility can be meaningfully addressed in actions taken on loss and damage, including loss and damage finance. So, Harjeet, Over to you.
Thank you, Nina. Thank you, RAED, NRC, and also Rosa-Luxemburg-Stiftung for organizing this conversation and inviting me. There's no doubt that the agenda of migration has got a lot of traction over the last few years because of the work that has happened and by organizations like you, RAED, I know. I remember you were telling in Bali that how you have been talking of displacement for a very long time in the disaster risk reduction space, but only now we see traction in the policy space. And a lot of technical work, you know, what IDMC and NRC have done, and many stories from the ground that we get. And we also got task force for displacement. The committees that were formed under UNFCCC to respond to loss and damage, the task force for displacement has done some stellar work, and we do see that as one of the benchmarks. I'm also part of the task force on technical expert group on risk management, and we always look at how a task force for displacement has really come up with its plans and how they are coordinating. And we also heard numbers of how 24 million people were displaced last year, and 6 million people were still displaced last year and could not be rehabilitated, and the number is much, much bigger for conflict. Now, what does that really indicate? Especially when we talk about the issues of displacement or migration, we need to understand that displacement or migration are epitome of climate impacts, which means when all local coping mechanisms failed, that's where people were either displaced or were forced to migrate, which means that all our efforts in terms of adaptation failed. We could not provide them support so that they could stay after they faced climate impacts. So which means that everything that we are talking about here in terms of loss and damage mechanism, the system has not provided a single penny. Had we responded in terms of humanitarian assistance or helped them recover, they would not leave their places. Which means it's a systemic failure that we have been seeing over the last few years when we talk about issues of displacement and migration. And these numbers do not even represent people who are forced to cross borders, and we know for all the political reasons that number is not captured. So I'm going to repeat the question that I asked when the Task Force for Displacement was doing its review in Madrid in 2019. And I'll repeat, while Task Force for Displacement has done some amazing work in terms of coordination, there are some big agencies, but the plans that are emerging from the task force, are they just the sum total of what all the agencies are doing, or more than some of their parts? Are we able to respond to the needs of people who are displaced? What about those 6 million people? And we also heard from IDMC that this is an underestimation. What's happening to those 6 million people? They're not numbers, they're people. Is this system, which has been created as a task force, is it helping us rehabilitate? Because we will keep seeing these numbers, and that's not enough. So how Task Force for Displacement is being resourced, empowered, to make sure that anybody who is displaced because of climate impacts, anybody who is forced to migrate, gets support. Otherwise, we'll come to these conferences and keep talking about these numbers. And this is where we need to understand where the politics is. And I can tell you where we are right now. You saw how the issue of loss and damage became really big over the last few months. And that's exactly what we are trying to do here. But there are efforts being made to depoliticize the issue. And simply now it's being said that it's a humanitarian issue, it's a DRR issue, and some of us were also in Bali at the Global Platform for Disaster Risk Reduction. And we do come from the humanitarian space. We know what game is being played. When you depoliticize it, which means that you have little accountability. And that's exactly what we have seen in the humanitarian sector. You know, impacts happen. No doubt there is solidarity. Humanitarian aid works on that, which is good, but not good enough. And we always talked about needs-based finance. That's not happening. And when we talk about human rights, each and every person who gets affected by climate impacts, and now science proves that, has a right to get support. That support is not going. And more we talk about this issue in those spaces, which is required, and we need everybody to be contributing. But let's also understand, if we move this issue outside UNFCCC, the accountability system is lost. And that's why we are fighting this battle on loss and damage and loss and damage finance here. Similarly, there are also efforts by G7, and I've been meeting all the delegations, met German delegation today, and we have been in touch with them. European delegation, you talk to Canadian delegation, the whole global protection shield has come up as a solution. It's not a solution. One, it's a repackaging of insurance. You know, when they created insurance in 2015, we criticized that it doesn't work for people. In developing countries, they said, we need resilience. They said, okay, why don't we offer you insure resilience? Same product, but a different packaging. And when we said even, and we engaged, we gave them inputs and constructive criticism. We did everything. It's not that we are only doing actions here. We are also sitting with them in the rooms and telling them what is wrong. And they said that, okay, fine, now you have put a lot more pressure. We'll package it even better. Global Protection Shield. Sounds great, right? But when you talk to them, whether it really stands and passes the test of the principles that we are talking about, you talk of equity, you talk of justice, you talk of access, adequacy, needs-based. No. It's still insurance, a little more pluses here and there. Yeah, and there's a talk of social protection, which we know how important it is to support communities who are facing displacement. It's just a talk. And more we create such systems on the outside, you know, the efforts are primarily to weaken this system. We are not saying those efforts are not required. Great, you know, at least you are recognizing, you are trying to do something. But the question is that enough? Or is that strengthening this system? Because we come to the UN system because we are fighting for global justice. You know, why we are here, because it's one country, one vote. We don't want G7 to decide how and who's going to be supported. We know how geopolitics plays a role in who gets the humanitarian aid. So it's extremely important to come here and strengthen this particular system. And we have been hearing about gaps, about data gaps and monitoring gaps and finance gap and laws and policy gaps. But we need to recognize why we have these kind of gaps. These are not just technical gaps that, and these are important things to highlight, and we have to really work on them. But the reason you have these gaps, because there is a gap of political will, there's a gap of solidarity, there's a gap of compassion, there's a gap of empathy, there's a gap of global cooperation. That's why you have all these gaps. The fundamental reason is that, you know, rich countries don't want to move forward. I was sitting with one of the delegations this morning, and they said, I said, you know, the discussion that we were having on Glasgow dialogue, ideally we did not need it. We had a Warsaw International Mechanism which had action and support as one of the functions. You did not allow that discussion to happen. When we put pressure, you created this, which is hanging on its own. We don't know where it's going to land. I said, yeah, at least we are talking. You know, I said, you are delaying, your delayed talks have killed people, have displaced people. So it's not that you are talking. You delayed the conversation by at least 8 years since we got the mechanism. We should have had this discussion way back in 2014. So I don't think there is still, that's why I say there's a gap in compassion, there's a gap in empathy. They don't realize, oh, just because now disasters are happening in the global north, there's a realization. And I was, you know, they shared an example that, oh yeah, because we had disasters, at least now we are saying adaptation and loss and damage are different. It took disasters in the global north to understand that adaptation and loss and damage are different. When we have been talking about millions being displaced, you know, no adaptation. The fight was, there is no definition on loss and damage. So I think we need to really understand why these gaps are, what needs to happen, and also how we as various communities who are working on specific issues really come together. The reason we could have so much of traction on loss and damage finance, because as civil society, we were together. As Climate Action Network and many of our allies came together and said, we have to put a spotlight on the issue of loss and damage finance, which was not even on the agenda. The whole issue of loss and damage, which is an Article 8 of Paris Agreement, is not even on the agenda. You know, that's why we were shouting, put loss and damage on the agenda. It's not even on the agenda. And if loss and damage is not on the agenda, which means people are not on the agenda. It's solar panels and wind turbines, that's what we are discussing. So that's not enough, and that's why we have to come together and unite our fight. And we have to talk about a common narrative. We have to talk about, you know, a common fight, which is for justice, which is for human rights, and demand that loss and damage finance facility, a system that is going to hold polluters to account, that's going to look at how many people are being displaced, why they are being displaced, and how they can be helped, how they can recover, how they can be rehabilitated. And we can't just talk about a fragmented system. We need a system here in the form of loss and damage finance facility, which can have that oversight, which can provide financial support, either through the system here, or even there are many financial streams outside. But we need that system to be established here at COP27. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Harjeet. And I think I don't need to repeat anything of what you said, but I really also think it's important to underline that, yes, we need data, but not having the perfect data doesn't mean we can't act, because we have enough information to act. So let's act and get data at the same time. Don't use it as an excuse. We have literally 5 minutes for comments or questions, because we need to be out of the room for the next people coming after. So if there are anyone who would like to make a comment, question, please put up your hand, and we will also try to monitor what happens online. Thank you for saying that. We have a microphone here. We have at least one arm up here in the front. Anyone else who would like to say something? Then I have two. Three. That's it. That's time. And be short, so all the three can say something.
Yes, thank you very much for presenting the lot of challenges, I feel. I'm also interested in the practices to address them. You also mentioned those. I'm particularly interested in preparing urban areas for IDPs, and with this, I wanted to hear what are your recommendation and experiences, what type of jobs for IDPs in urban areas could be there. So would be really interested to hear an opinion or some practical solution on this for the Arab region. And my name is Sandra Schuss, I work for GIZ, so thank you for that.
We take all the three questions and then we try to respond as much as possible. Please introduce yourself when you speak.
Hello everyone, thank you so much for this wonderful discussion. My name is Qiyamuddin and I'm one of the youth representing the United Nations Major Group for Children and Youth. I will give you a short like feedback, and then I will have a very small question. You are right that there is no such kind of like coordination between no such kind of actions on this agenda. But this is happening. But for the last so many years, we have seen that many people, they have been migrating, and also they are displacing. No such kind of proper and actions have been taken by the relevant authorities. And my question would be, because in the context of a country like Afghanistan, there is no development right now. They don't have the, for example, how they are reducing the exposure, vulnerability, and hazard. And the risk is just greater and greater day by day. And people are just displacing, not because of the conflict, but because of the drought as well. And that drought and the environmental hazard that is hidden, and that is not, I think it cannot be like the way it is. And because many people they are dependent on the agriculture, and they are living in the rural areas. Because of drought, they have been migrated to the cities, and that was the temporary displaced. But in the context of this, because of the political system collapse, now there is no development. So like in this context, only the humanitarian assistance has been providing to the temporary displaced people. But whether you think that is only enough to provide the humanitarian assistance to the people in this context, this is just like a case study, but it can be happen everywhere in the world. So in this context, whether only humanitarian assistance only works, or we need to do something else as well, because the other things are not working properly. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Then we have one more question or comments. And if I can ask you to be brief.
I'll keep it very short. Thank you. David Hall, I work with the climate champions looking at loss and damage. One quick reflection. I remember the UK going to a foresight report in 2011 on global environment change and migration. Most of that just had excellent report and obviously just completely lost. But a quick question is, sometimes when migration is a positive, so we should encourage people to migrate as well, how to support that. And also, is it also about, you know, how do we put more money to diversify people's livelihoods? You know, is that something we should be thinking about? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think these are questions that some are difficult for anyone that respond to, others everyone would like to respond to. But the first question was very much linked to the Arab region, and we have three speakers, which I would. You don't all need to speak, but if you want to, I would like first to call upon Ambassador Shahira if she would like to say something, and then Emad, and also of course Sama. So let's see. But if you start with Ambassador.
The problem of displacement in the Arab region and refugee problem is outstanding due to internal instability as well as to climate change and disasters. So we are dealing with a de facto situation of the existence. So what we are doing at the moment is the response to what is happening. But what I think many of the people around us, they have talked about means of response, about the damage and loss, and how to compensate these people. My first and main concern is that we do not let these phenomenon take place in the first place. Why do people get displaced or become refugees? This is the core issue. We will not have an issue if we address the core problem of displacement and refugee problems in the world. And this is the problem of development. In the Arab region particularly, we have varying degrees of development. And we have six least developed countries. And whatever development is taking place is being stifled by the political instability. So how can we address these core issues that would address the bottom of the problem of displacement and refugees? So we have discussed all the issues around it, the data, the how to make their life less miserable, how to let them live a dignified life, the compassion, and all these things. These are very good things. I think we are looking for financial assistance in the first place to be put into the issue of refugees. This is going to be temporary solutions. However, sustainable solution is addressing the core, and that is providing financing through all the mechanisms for climate change to address the core which made these people move from their places, including governance, including all the repercussions of climate change, particularly drought and desertification. Many of the political instability is taking place due to scarce resources. Resources became scarce due to climate change and the different patterns of production in different areas in the whole region. Many people have outlined the issue of water scarcity and how this issue can be at the bottom of continuous instability and even maybe conflicts. So my point, I reinforce it, is addressing the cost of displacement through climate change financing. The climate change finance address the core issues. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. We will have less than a minute, Emad, if you want to come in.
Because the question was very clear about employment for IDPs in the urban areas. I think this is one of the things that I find it very challenging, and also I would say that it doesn't have the minimum of the rights for the for those people who are moved. But unfortunately, they get many jobs, but because they are proposed as underpaid, almost always they are underpaid. There is no system to do this, but I see them in when I saw in Lebanon, in Jordan, in Egypt. I saw the IDPs in the urban areas. Most of them are working, you know, in construction business. In business where they need, you know, low quality low underpaid labor forces. So I think they don't have this kind of social protection, and there is no system for them to get. But to be honest, in many of the cases, I noticed that they come and they have more skills than the people that are already in the urban areas, because they are not. There are many of the jobs that needs this type of skillful people coming from outside. So this is what I think. It's a challenge that has to be put also on how we are dealing with the IDPs and the rights for the IDPs when they move from one place to another. Sometimes they get, if they are across borders, you get from IOM or for WFP, they get some support, but not for employment, but just, you know, for providing them with the minimum of resources that could help them. But this is not enough. There has to be a system in which, you know, those people could be treated as, I don't want to say first class, but at least, you know, the very similar class citizen of the urban areas. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's tough to have to cut people off like that. Sama, you've been patiently waiting. Can you be even shorter than Emma?
I'll be super quick, but I have to divert a bit. Apologies. On the question of jobs, I think, yes, of course, we need social protection safety nets. We need contingency plans for inevitable unemployment that we're seeing. But I think we need to be more visionary as well. And here I would emphasize the need for us to really harness our renewable energy potential in this region. Why don't we start investing in the solar and wind potential of these countries in our region and start looking at it as an opportunity for new jobs and to make that transition to a new clean and green economy? I mean, there's vast resources and potential in this region to do that. And perhaps we need donor countries to use their diplomatic force and donor financial assistance to really push countries in our region towards that direction as well. So I'll leave it there. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Sama, and thank you for being short. I think maybe you would like to say something. We see you on camera, but I don't know if you wanted to, but if you want, you have the chance.
Yes. Thank you. I think I just want to say just to add to what other speaker already said, like what Ima believe that all policies should reflect the realities on the ground. Now, I think in the climate migration crisis, for example, climate crisis and migration, we really propose to have a two approach. One is the really in-depth study on the macro study on the climate crisis itself. But the study must be really socialized to the broader migrants community, so people will be more aware on the connection of climate crisis and migration. And again, climate crisis has been seen as separate issues with other part of our life, which is actually not true. The second aspect is what I mentioned in my speech, that to start what kind of reform that we want, what kind of protection we want for the migrants, for example, or the affected community, we really have to start with them. What do they want, you know? We cannot like decide for them because we are not them. So I think the best way is really to involve them in any discussion on climate crisis and also give them more platform and opportunities for them to speak up. And I think this is going to be very, very important as we are trying to strengthen the voices, the call for the climate crisis response I think this kind of voices and united, aspiration will be very, very important and also become our bargaining tool with the government and other stakeholders. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will put up a slide here that I also think you can see online with a tentative summary for key takeaways. We will leave it there. And one time he doesn't have time.
Still have, I
think. No, we don't have time. You have to be out, sorry. So I will be impolite moderator and close the session showing the key takeaways. But I also want very much, as we leave the room, come back to the one comment about people on the move, because I think one thing we see popping up when we talk about the politics is that people say, oh, we need to do something about climate change so we stop people from moving. We don't want people to migrate there. So these shouldn't be put against each other. People have and should have a right to move with dignity, with generous migration possibilities. We want to try to reduce the displacement risk, but we don't want to reduce displacement. People need to have the right to run away when needed. We shouldn't stop them. So I think this is, again, going back to the whole human rights space, and let's deal with the reality and not get stuck in excuses because we don't know everything or something might lead to this or that. This is about working with and for people. Thank you very much, and good luck with meetings, discussions. Next week, there's another session on these issues on the 14th. Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you.